I would like it more to be an interaction and an open dialogue, because that's what I believe in. First of all, thanks to the organizers, thanks to Chemtech, and particularly to all the participants who are investing their time in this important topic. You know, this is very close to me, very close to my heart. Of course, you know, I'm known to be an AHS professional. I've been in the field for last 30 plus years. I'm very excited actually to share my views with all of you. And the reason is, you know, I'm a Bombay boy. I'm a Desi man. Okay. So grew up in Bombay. Yes, I was, I'm a VJTI graduate. Of course, later on, I did my MBAs and got my certifications, international certifications, etc. But I cut my teeth very much here in Bombay. And I'm sure there are people in this audience or their predecessors to whom I owe a tremendous gratitude. I cut my teeth in Nosil, which was a flagship company of Arvind Mafatlal Group in you know, early 60s and 70s and 80s. I worked in Nosil for almost 10 years from 1988 to 1998. And then I helped Owens Corning establish their operations in India from 98 to 2002. And then, of course, for last many years, I've been outside India. And the gratitude I have is because I have learned a lot from all of you, from the people who are on this call and many others who preceded them in the fine chemicals and specialty chemicals industries and so on. I was actually between 1993 to about 96, 97, I was very deeply involved in the common effluent treatment plants and in WAPI, in Thane Belapur belt, and later on in Taloja industrial area. And that actually gave me a good insight about you know, many of the challenges that the small and medium scale manufacturers in chemical industry particularly face. And many of those challenges were in the areas of health, safety, and environment. And what I learned from them is absolutely invaluable, because you all are great entrepreneurs. You all know how to run it. You know, I was just a young engineer trying to learn the tricks and the ropes. And my biggest learning was when I interacted with these 400 plus different level of executives, entrepreneurs, owners, managers, and I got to know what is the reality of challenges in the area of health, safety, and environment. And then, of course, that became the foundation for me. And as I moved on to different roles globally, I could use those examples and those learnings to be a better professional and to be a better server for the industry. So let me start with a story, and I'm sure this will be interesting for all of you. So during the common effluent treatment plant days, you know, we used to collect samples from every industry, and then there was a team of my own people who would analyze the sample, and then we would go to the industry with the results, and I would have this dialogue with this chat about, you know, okay, here is the problem, here is what you can do about it, here is how we are going to treat, you know, or here is how we are going to help you, this is what is the charge is going to be. And so, you know, I went to one of the industries, and you know, I said to them, you know, I'm telling you, your problem is BOD and COD. And they said, what the heck, you know, we didn't call you to tell me that, because I know that for last so many days. You know, my problem always is the board of directors and the charter of demands. And that's where it started, right? That's where I said, okay, which means, you know, I need to work harder in understanding, you know, what the real issues are and how I can make HSE as a part of business. And that's what I'm going to talk to you about. You know, because the BOD and COD for this entrepreneur and for this medium scale industry was totally different than what I was thinking about. But here is what I want to share with you today. Why is HSE important? Why health, safety, and environment matters? That is a key question. And that is a key question I would like all of you to ask yourself, internalize it, and think about it. Fundamentally, it is about doing the right thing. And we all want to do the right thing. So look at any person who comes to work for us. Look at anybody who may not work for us, but who may be a supplier, who may be a truck driver, who comes to our factories and who delivers material, or who picks up our loads and takes it to the nearby port. Or it could be one of the customers and, you know, a customer employee. It is about us, all of us, doing the right things for all our stakeholders, our employees, their families, our, you know, customers, our suppliers, our contractors, our our logistics providers, everyone. So to me, that is the fundamental thing. It is about doing the right thing. No one comes to work to get hurt. No one comes to work to say, you know what, I'm going to, you know, get three fingers of my hand chopped today when I go back home. No one comes to work to do that. Also, no one on this call and beyond this call wants to do something wrong. I have no doubt about it. You know, all of us are having all the best intentions and the best views about everybody around us in life. But then something goes wrong, something happens. So the work as imagined, as planned, doesn't happen. Something else happens, it drifts, it goes into a different direction. And that's when an incident, an accident, a chemical release, a spill, you know, something goes wrong. And for us as the leaders of the industry, for us as the leaders of our people, we need to think about that from that perspective. And that is what I have always been thinking about. And that is what I try to put in practice when I work with, you know, executives, when I work with managers, when I work with the board of directors. That is how I approach health, safety, and environment. It's about what is happening on the field, what is happening in reality, versus what we are imagining, what we are thinking about as the work as planned, the work as designed, because there are things going to happen. People are going to be distracted. Sometimes the procedures may not work. Sometimes the quality of raw material that we receive may not be exactly on spec. And, you know, something will happen. Maybe there will be a runaway reaction. Maybe there will be an upset. Maybe there will be a temperature spike, a pressure rise, whatever. Our job as the leaders is to make sure that we anticipate these risks. We think about these risks and we make sure that our processes, our systems, our people are ready to handle and manage these risks. The second thing is, all of us, all our people are human beings. We all make mistakes. And some of the mistakes can be very expensive. Some of the mistakes can be just an error, you know, and we all make mistakes. So again, as the leaders of our pack, what we need to think about is, we cannot make our workplace mistake-free, but how can we make it mistake-resilient? We should have processes, we should have systems which can absorb certain part of that error, certain part of that mistake. We should build in safeguards about how can we absorb these mistakes? How can our process and system tolerate these mistakes? And that is also a very key thing, especially in today's world where there are lots of stresses, there are lots of distractions, there are lots of competing priorities. You know, the smartphone and all this social media is great, but the distraction it causes on the shop floor in our day-to-day lives is huge. How can we build those changing technologies in our day-to-day world? I want all of you to think about it. I will come to some of the challenges I have seen closely. You know, once again, I'll come back to my roots. You know, though I have been outside India for almost last 20 years now, I do come to India almost every year, and I do work with a lot of industries still in India trying to help them improve, trying to help them do something differently. They may be our customers, they may be my old friends, my colleagues, or there may be some industries that I was involved in before. And I'll give you three examples that I have seen in the last 2 years, and I hope they hit home for you. So the first one is, this is a medium scale fine chemicals industry. Obviously, I'm not going to mention that, but they were going through a massive offer from a private equity group from the United States. And I was asked by the owner of this group to help them understand the expectations of this private equity group from Americas. And they were in the middle of a massive, I don't know whether I should call it as acquisition, as merger, but they were going to get almost $85 million pumped into as equity capital from this private equity group for expansion. And where things got stalled was when they did a due diligence from a team of experts in America, and these American experts said that they found the firefighting system and some of the safety management systems in that factory. And in fact, they had three factories in different parts of India. They found that there were common lack of systems and processes around firefighting, around emergency management, and around some of the process safety requirements. And they basically went back to this group and said, we cannot go ahead with this deal unless you fix it. They wanted them to be NFPA 30 compliant. And I can tell you that this work is costing this company a lot of money, and it is also costing this company a lot of time. So the whole timeline of this merger / acquisition has got stretched by 14 months. And just imagine the opportunity and opportunity cost that this has posed. So this is one example. The second example is, there's another group which is in the areas of glass and ceramics and more into that, they're expanding into injectables. Very important in today's world where everybody is creating the coronavirus, the vaccines, and the demand for injectables has just shot up. And this group, very capable group, in my opinion, very entrepreneurial, but they had difficulties in terms of getting the right level of certifications and approvals in terms of selling their injectables and selling their glass containers for this different type of manufacturing. Again, the issues came back to their waste disposal practices and their health and safety practices. So these are two direct examples that I can give from my experience in the recent 12 to 18 months, where an Indian industry faced increasing level of challenges and missed quite a big business opportunities in terms of their growth. And I hope they make sense to you. The third example I'm going to give is kind of a reverse of that. And this is also a big group. And I was very peripherially, very tertially involved in this, but I know it for a fact. And this group has acquired many small manufacturing units in Europe and in Americas. And as they acquired it, the board of directors and the senior leadership team, the executive team of this company, has become increasingly aware of the challenges, of the risks and liabilities that are posed, because now they have got exposed to the American courts, to the American judicial system, to the European enforcement requirements, to the European Union requirements, the European Commission, and so on and so forth. And their risk profile has suddenly increased, which is putting a lot of strain on their finances, the way they are managing their reserves, the way they are keeping some of their liabilities at bay. Again, this is an example I wanted to quote to you, because this is important. As you all are expanding your businesses, I know I'm so proud about the Indian chemical industries, the way we are expanding, and we are expanding globally in different countries. And I wanted all of you to think about these aspects. Now, I will come to a very different level. You know, the other part of change that I see, and I see it very, very, very often, is the perception and the expectations from the new generation of employees, the new generation of workers that we are going to source from. And I'll give you two examples. So as I said, I did a lot of work in WAPI area. And, you know, I spent a lot of time there. I used to spend 2 days a week for about 8 months when the construction and commissioning of the WAPI Industries Association Effluent Treatment Plant was going on. So I used to spend, you know, the evenings in WAPI, and I can tell you 30 years ago, it was quite a polluted place. And I know it is improved quite a lot now. And it's all kudos to all of you. But at that time, you know, in the evening, the WAPI area used to have a lot of haze and a lot of, you know, you could see a kind of heaviness in air. And there were some very nice people with whom I worked. And sometimes, you know, they would invite me home, and they would say, hey, you know, I know you stay all alone yourself, you know, come home for dinner or whatever. And many a times the conversation would kind of turn around to, you know, their family member or their wife or their children or their son or their daughter, saying, you know, this area is not really great to live for the next 15, 20 years. So, you know, hum log yahan pe 3-4 saal rahenge, baad mein dekhenge kahan Bombay, nahi to aur dusri jagah kahin pe opportunity milti hai to, lekin ye polluted jagah mein nahi rehna hai. And that's what, you know, used to always ring a bell in my mind, because I'm a Bombay boy. You know, I used to think, well, you know, I'm taking this better air and, you know, clean water, etc., for granted in Mumbai. You know, I never had to think about it, though I stayed in Sion, which used to be very close to, you know, it was very polluted even at that time, but not anything like WAPI or some of those areas in those days. And it made me think about, you know, when we talk about attrition, when we talk about employee retention, you know, how much was that impact? I could not quantify it, but definitely there was an impact. There were people who were coming in, working for 2 years, 3 years, get some experience and leave. You know, how much does that impact you and your operations? Because now you have to retrain the employees, you have to get a new one. Always there is a learning curve, always there is inefficiency, always there is something that we lose when we lose experienced employees. Fast forward 30 years, I was there last year, and I was in a different industrial belt in Konkan area. And, you know, I had hired a car, and there was a driver who took me to this factory. And I was actually talking to the factory manager. I spent a day there. I just love to do that out of my own passion, just to learn, you know, what is going on, how the industry is evolving. At the end of the day, 5:30, I walk out of the gate looking for my car driver, and I don't see my car. And I'm like, okay, you know, maybe this driver has gone out to drink tea. So I walk to the nearby thela, you know, also good opportunity for me to grab, you know, some fresh samosas and chai and all this, which I miss here in Europe or America. And then I called my driver on cell phone, and he said, "Ha, saab, 5 minutes mein aata hun." And he came, and I said, "Okay, you know, where did you go?" I thought, you know, and he said, "Sir, kya hai ki, you know, I was talking to this chai wala, and he said, you know, last year there was a big fire in this factory, not this factory, but the factory next to it. And, you know, this factory is not the best and not the safest. And I see all these emissions, and I smell a different type of chemical. So, you know, I thought this is not good enough for me to stay here for the whole day. So I just, you know, drove away a kilometer away. And I was, you know, sitting there in a ped ke niche, a chhau mein baitha tha. And again, it made me think about the perception that people form. You know, I'm sure this driver, if he had an opportunity, he would tell people around him, saying, "Nahi yaar, wahan pe kaam mat karo." So again, the new employees, the new workforce, they are demanding these things for granted. They are demanding a clean workplace. They are demanding a safe workplace. They have that expectation. And we as leaders need to make sure to fulfill those expectations, so that we get good workforce, we get engaged workforce, we get that the right level and talent of people who will come and work for us and take us to the next level. You know, this is my hunch, no data around it, but as you all have seen, you know, the supply or the our customers, especially for people who export chemicals and, you know, who do a lot of work with companies in Europe and America, they are going to demand very different level of health, safety and environmental standards in future. That is just my gut feel based on what I've seen in the past. You know, 10 years ago, a lot of textile manufacturers in India, a lot of, you know, carpet manufacturers in India faced almost like an embargo because of child labor issues. I would not be surprised if the HSE becomes something similar in future, almost about, you know, we are going to hold you to very high level of standards. So that's what, you know, those are my perceptions. Those are my experiences. I wanted to share those with you very openly, very honestly. As I said, you know, I'm very proud of our industry. I feel myself to be a part of the industry. I feel myself that, you know, I've kind of grown up because of a lot of people on this call and their predecessors. End of the day, you know, I always would like all of you to think about my first point. You know, HSE, health, safety, and environment, I call this as the human side of enterprise. This is really how we demonstrate that we care. This is how we give a promise to our employees that we go home safely every day. This is what we promise to our communities around us, that they can be free and they don't have to care, or they don't have to worry about, because we are in their vicinity, right? So, you know, this is what I would like to kind of give as my offer. Always available to you for any advice, any support, anything I can share with you, anything I can help you with, because I owe a lot to this industry. I owe a lot to all of you. And with this, I'm going to conclude. I'm going to just recite something. I mean, just narrate something. Because like many others, you know, I'm a Marathi person, and Something That Guides Us is a great book called Gnaneshwari. And in Gnaneshwari, it talks about, you know, it gives an example that a mother, you know, she gets all the ingredients, she cooks the food, and she, you know, she is very happy when she is feeding her child. And one day the child turns around and tells her mom, saying, "Hey, mom, actually, today, let me feed you." And this lecture, this session, actually, I thought was an opportunity for me like that, because I've learned so much from this industry. And I thought this was a good way for me to share my experience and my learnings with all of you, and my views and my request, and my, you know, to translate my passion into kind of creating an urge for you. I hope I am successful to a certain extent.